Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I will discuss on gender issue, or to explain it, on the issue of relationship between men and women in Islam, and what Islam says about women and men, and their rights, and their status. But before that, let me say this, that in the whole world, the gender issue or man-woman issue is still very, very important. A day, a week has been observed recently, this year, throughout the world, on how to stop oppression on women. In Bangladesh, a statement was issued by 16 women leaders, including some ambassadors, that this program should follow to save women from oppression and torture. This is true in the United States, in Europe, America, maybe in all of Africa, and also in Muslim countries, maybe less or maybe not less, but this is the reality. And historically, one point is important, just to know, because if the record remains, people may benefit. Somehow, in the history, always men dominated, and women did not dominate. And because of domination, women were oppressed in history. Why men dominated, I cannot say. Women dominated only in few societies, some African societies, some Upojati societies, or like Shautal society, or Garo society, such societies, women dominate and work more than men. But in history, by and large, men dominated. And most of the laws that we have read and seen were not in favor of women. Two groups were badly treated. One was the slaves. Throughout history, slaves were badly treated. In Islam, only slaves got good treatment, Islam says. Islam says also this, that one of the best work of good Muslim is fakku rakabatin, freeing the slaves. Allah says, have you seen Aqaba? Have you seen the hard way? Have you seen the hard way, Aqaba? Difficult way to achieve iman, to achieve piety. It is fakku rakabatin. And I do not want to go to slavery, but I want to just say that now slavery has ended. And when slavery was there, the slaves in Muslim world was better. I am not justifying that everything was okay, I am not saying. The other group, which did not fare well, is women. And women in Islam, Dr. Jamal Badawi has said very clearly in his book, Islam Teaching Course, in G-Series. The G-Series, it deals with women issues and social issues. That in early Islam, women had all the rights and privileges, but then they lost. Gradually they lost for many reasons. They were stopped even from going to masjid. This he has said. And then he says that the presently Muslim movements and Muslim leaders are trying to give women the same status, essentially equal. For example, if you look into Surah Nisa, verse 1, Ayat 1, it says that all men were created from, all men and women were created from Adam and Hawa, and spread them. And in this Ayat, in the last part, Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامَ and fear Allah. In whose name you demand rights. And fear Rahim. Sayyid Qutb says in his translation that this is that he has said not rights of relation. He said it should be here. Here it will be Oms. And says that such a language has not been used in any book or any religious book in history as Allah has used here. So if we really feel this one ayat is sufficient, that what is the status of women? If one ayat is sufficient, all other ayats in favor of men, if they are nothing compared to this. That they are Oms. Then Allah says about that in Hujjatul Bida, Fear al Hajj, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said a very great thing. He said, no non-Arab is superior to an Arab. No black is superior to white, and no white is superior to black. Now, Arab includes men and women. Non-Arab includes men and women. White includes men and women. Black includes men and women. So actually Allah says, all human beings are equal. Prophet has said it. But we forget that women are included here. About Surah Al-Jumma, that Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu idha nudiya lis-salat yawm al-jumma fasaw ila dhikrillah. Here women are included. But as I said before, that women are not included. I mean, no arrangement is there for women to attend Jumma prayer. Why? This should not have happened. Small fatwas are used against the Quranic verse. The priority of Quranic verse is neglected. But in any event, Hujjatul Bida, the speech of the Prophet proves that all human beings are really equal. Now, there is a question whether. And Quran also says another thing, that no superiority except taqwa. In Surah Al-Hujurat, it is said that you have been created from one man and one woman, and then you have been made into tribes and sub-tribes, or nations or sub-nations, or groups and sub-groups, that are only for identification, knowing each other, to say you are such and such, and I am such and such. Not for anything else. It is no other purpose. It does not support nationalism. In a sense, the world knows no nationalism, Islam does not support it. Islam says that there are groups, okay, but no superiority, no nationalism. Of the time we know now, present kind of nationalism has been born only 300 years back. In early human history, there was no nationalism. There was internationalism, big empire, internationalism. Many groups together in an empire, whether Christian empire or Muslim empire, or Buddhist empire. Another thing, sometimes people think that women are inferior in body. They are smaller in size, etc., etc. But Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Al-Teen very, very clearly, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. That Allah has created human beings, insan, not men, not women. فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Best of molds. Everything best. Allah Ta'ala has given man what is best for him. Allah Ta'ala has given woman what is best for her. Because man has a duty, woman has a duty. Equal duty, but slightly different duty also. We will discuss that there are common duties, but then there are some special duties. So Allah has taken care of that. And man should not say against the ayat, there is no way of superior in body. And only big thing is, only big size is good, you cannot say. Huh? Elephant is big size, that doesn't mean it is superior to human being. Men are big size, I agree with the woman. But I have seen more heart attacks on men than women. Why? If they are so strong, why more heart attacks of men? Okay, there is no ayat in the Quran which says man is superior. There is no ayat. But at least there is one ayat for women. which indicates that woman is probably superior. It says in Surah Imran about the birth of Hazrat Isa alayhi salam. After birth of Maryam, first, her mother said, "Oh God, oh Allah, I have got a girl, not a boy. I have got a girl, not a boy." What Allah says, Allah knows better than you. And then Allah says, out of context and also in context, that Laisal Zakaru Kalunsa. Men are not like women. And in Arabic custom, in Arabic language, when it says men are not like women, that means women is the standard, man is the substandard. So at least if somebody wants, he can say that no, woman has, at least in one ayat Allah has said that woman has some excellence over men in some respects, if not in all respects. So men should not be so proud. And then I am coming to about the duties of men and women. It's true, I will discuss later, that women have some separate duties and men have some separate duties, no doubt about it. That women have the duty of motherhood, which is the most important duty and most difficult duty of humanity. We men should remember that the duty that woman does of motherhood, of taking, child in the womb, and then suffering and giving birth in great pain, and then upbringing, nourishing, whose duty is more than this? But do men realize? Main duties, as Allah Ta'ala says in Suratul Tawbah, ayat number 71. Al-mu'minatu ba'duhum awliya wa ba'din. Men and women, they are guardian to each other, friend to each other, either guardian to each other or friend to each other, or supporter to each other. And what is their job? Ya'muruna bil ma'ruf. One job. They'll do order good deeds. Try to establish good deeds. Vayanhana anil munkar. Try to stop bad deeds. Of men's duty, women's duty. Yukimuna salata. Men's duty, women's duty. Yutuna zakata. Men's duty, women's duty. Yutim Allah. That they obey Allah. They must obey Allah. Wa Rasulahu and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the common duties of men and women. And this Amru bil Maruf wa Nahy anil Munkar includes actually all social work, all politics, all economics. In fact, this Amru bil Maruf is the key of Islam, Nahy anil Munkar, to purify society, to change society, to build society, to develop society. And all these duties are of men and women. But we think, no, women have no duty. They should remain in house and do nothing. Of course, I have already said that women have special duty and men have special duty. Women's special duty is motherhood, which I have explained already. I am not explaining. The most difficult task for any human. Men's special duty is qawwam. They have to maintain the family and protect the family. This is the special duty of men, and that is the special duty of women. And then I will go to some questions which are asked about this. I will not explain everything in a short way. I will say that, for example, people sometimes say that women have less intelligence. But I think in the Suratul Teen, that ayat, "Laqad khalaqna insana fi ahsani taqwim," it shows that even if this intelligence is short, Allah has compensated it another way. If, for example, Allah says in another place, you will remember the part, that khalaqal insana daifan, men and women, insan, have been created weak. So weakness has been also in men. There is no reason to see that weakness is only in women. It is not true. All human beings have weakness. So I have said about this witnessing. Jamal Badawi says actually no difference. There are people who say that women cannot be judges. Women cannot be judged, etc. I mean, opinions, Sikh opinions in the Middle Ages have been more or less not very favorable to women, unfortunately. I don't know why, whether they were born from the womb of the mother or not, I don't know. But this is the situation. I have said about Uttas, and then now about polygamy, I would not explain. I will ask those who are listening or will be listening that you read the book of Jamal al-Badawi, the Islamic teaching course, and the book of Abdul Halim Busukka, Women, right at the time of the Prophet, in 6 volumes. It is available in Bangla and also in English. You can say, I will also say that marrying more than one is not, Islam has not said it is ideal. It has not said that this is ideal, marrying more than one. Adam had one wife. Noah alayhi salam, to my best knowledge, had one wife. Most of the prophets had one wife. Except Ibrahim had two wives. And that also when Sarah was not said you marry this woman because you were not getting child. And Isa alayhi salam did not marry. To my best knowledge, Harun and Musa had one wife. So maybe Dawood had more wives. Maybe Dawood or Sulaiman. So most of the prophets had, and the ideal should be Adam and Hawa. And Allah has allowed it for very special reasons. Very special reasons. And there also Allah has said that if you do not cannot do justice, you must not. And in the modern state, Muslim state, in every country almost, because of abuse by men, abuse by uneducated men, or careless men, the restriction has been imposed in most of the countries that you cannot marry second time, or if you marry, you have to take the permission of the state that you really require. You really require. You have to take the permission. And Dr. Jamal Badawi said that it should not be banned, because that will be against violation of Allah's law. It should not be banned, because that will be violation of Allah's law. But state can always restrict, because in Islamic history, there are many examples when government restricted a halal thing, but restricted. For example, I give one example, small, as far as I remember, that Umar radiallahu anhu restricted that nobody can bring any cattle in Medina unless he also brings fodder with that. This restriction was not there. In Sharia there is no such restriction, but he restricted. Similarly, many other cases, that state restricted. This is permission. I say, okay. And the last thing is one about hoor. People say men will get many, many hoors. Now, in this aspect, I only simply say 2-3 things. One, Allama Asad says, Muhammad Asad says that men and women, their husband and wife, they will be. And poor in, the Quran says, poor in is actually pure companion, meaning wife or meaning husband. This is what he says. Muhammad Ali Tafsirkar has said the same thing. Sayyid Abul Ala Maududi has said in Surah Al-Rahman, that they are small children, girls. In Surah Al-Rahman, the last 3-4 ayat and its note, he says that poor is those small children who died, and Allah will raise them in Jannah. They will not get Jannah for their amal, but because they are small children. And Allah will make them they will serve the Jannatis, whether men or women. As there are Gulgilman, boys who will die young, and they will also be serve, not servant, but serve them. Mawlana Maudhuri says this about Hur, and all these are unnecessary talk that 72 Hurs will get, or many others or many less. So I think that Allah, there is no good reason why in Jannah Allah will make a distinction between men and women. When Allah says in Suratul Azab, Inna al-mu'minina wa al-muslimina wa al-muslimate, al-mu'minina wa al-mu'minate, etc., etc., Adallahu lahu magfiratan wa ajran azima. Allah has made no distinction. So what is the reason that, and there will be no conjugal line, there will be no children also produced. There is good, no good reason to give special treatment to men. So I finish here. I may not have said everything correct, but Allah may forgive me if I have said anything wrong. And the editor should edit it in a good way, so that what it should reach, people only should read. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.